Welcome to the Jackson School of International Studies. I'm Jim Wellman. I'm the chair of the Comparative Religion Program here at the Jackson School. I never thought I would be a teacher in an international school, but the amazing thing is Comparative Religion is within our International Studies program. And so it's a lovely place to work and teach in a global environment. And I was talking to Dr. Jennings, and I said, to have the title, Theology, in a title for a program tonight is very unusual for us. So I'm also very excited to have that. So I want to introduce Dr. Kuss, and he's going to make the major introduction.
Yes, well, thank you, Dr. Wellman. Yes, and we are not brothers, even though people may have heard that. When we were separated at birth, it was a painful story.
No.
And we're both going through the wounds. But the healing's begun, Jim, has it not? Anyway, we'll leave it that way. My name is Jeff Kuss. I'm a professor at Seattle Pacific University. But I'm here in the capacity as the general editor for an academic journal, Literature and Theology, which is published by Oxford University Press, which is sponsoring, in large part, our event this evening. And so I'm going to tell you a little bit about the work of the journal and a little bit about the philosophy behind our work at Oxford University Press and our hope for what's going to be the outcome as well tonight with Professor Jennings as our lecturer for this evening. The journal Literature and Theology, just to give you some history, began in the mid-80s, really as an attempt to provide a space for conversation. Not bound exclusively by one academic discipline, not a siloed sense of it. As universities have moved forward in time, this is true in the medieval universities of Oxford, Sorbonne, Cambridge, many of the disciplines have become more and more ingrained in their territories and in their turfs. This journal arose from a desire to talk about meaning. What does it mean to be human? And the idea of literature and theology really came from Anglican priests in England seeking out conversation partners outside of theology, the multiple disciplines that make up what a human being is, the sciences, the humanities, engineering, education, to better inform what it means to be human in a broader sense. The title, Literature and Theology, has been a difficult one for us throughout the decades of the journal's life. When we talk about literature, we don't want it to be bound merely to literary studies or textuality. When we talk about theology, as Dr. Wellman talked about, we also want that to be broader than merely some kind of doctrinal groundedness, but something bigger than that. What it means to think religiously, what it means to have spirituality, what it means to participate in culture in a deep and abiding way. And this problem of literature and theology for us in the journal's work and in the international community that makes up the International Society for Religion, Literature, and Culture, which gives a lot of energy to our work, has really been trying to seek how do we find expression for cultural imagination, philosophical thinking, hermeneutical strategies, critical theorizing, gender interrogation, historical reevaluation, political discourse, social practice, all these things that animate what it means to be human that so often get pushed aside and locked up in separate boxes and don't come together and talk to each other, which is what human beings do when they're fully embodied and walking around in their skin and their identities. If we do not accept that the terms have to be separate, then we have to bring them into conversation. And that's part of our work at the journal, and that's what's been our history. These borderlines, these ambiguous borderlines that often make up a university, like the University of Washington, Seattle Pacific, the Seattle School, and many of the other universities and colleges that make up Western culture, continue to shy away from the scary work of bending our heads over to cross the fences of our disciplines and ask, can you help us learn what we don't know? And that's the job of this journal, is to honestly ask, we don't know enough, can you help us? This annual lecture began in 2010 with a desire to lift up voices that are critical in our world, who are asking that question in a profound way and embody much of what the journal has hoped to do in its work. In 2010, our first lecturer was Professor Jeffrey Hartman, who found his home primarily in literary studies at Oxford, but he ventured out into comparative literature and started pushing the boundaries of what that discipline meant. And in that first lecture that we celebrated as part of our journal's work, Professor Hartman challenged universities to remember that knowledge does not move most effectively from a microcosm to a macrocosm, that is to say, a single discipline, making grand claims on how everybody else should see reality, but that we should move from one place to the other, what he called a mesochasm, an ecosystem of disciplinary activity swirling together in conversation like a choir of voices singing. And as we heard today, those who were with us at the panel at Seattle Pacific this afternoon, and was challenged by many of our panelists, with Professor Lasworth, who is here in the audience, and also Shel Stearns, who is also here from the Seattle School, and Professor Jennings, sometimes that choir needs to be discordant, sometimes it needs to be disruptive, and sometimes it refuses resolution so that we have to see each other in our bodies. This year's annual lecture is going to be brought to us tonight by Professor Jennings, and let me give you a short bio for him. Professor Willie Jennings is one of the country's most distinguished scholars in the areas of theology and race, and just recently joined the faculty at Yale Divinity School, where previously he was at Duke Divinity School, now as the Associate Professor of Systematic Theology and Africana Studies at Yale. His work has been brought up by many of people as far as the grandeur of his first book, The Christian Imagination, Theology and the Origin of Race with Yale, which won the American Academy of Religion Award of Excellence as a study of religion in constructive, reflective categories. He is a graduate of Calvin College, received his MDiv from Fuller. We're alumni on that one, so there you go. Hey, there you go, woo! And his PhD in religion and ethics from Duke. But I think one of the greatest testimonies to Professor Jennings' legacy is he continues to be a voice for us in our country, in our world, and to disrupt the easy siloing of knowledge and try to pull us back into embodied reality has been the legacy of his students. And Professor Brian Bantam, who's my colleague at Seattle Pacific University, Associate Professor of Theology, stands tall as his own type of scholar. He will also be with us tonight, providing voice. And I also want to particularly ask if we can give a special thank you to Professor Bantam, who really made this event in this day. You'll be hearing from Professor Bantam later today. But without further ado, please welcome the Literature and Theology 2015 Annual Lecture, Professor Willie Jennings.
I think that's better. Testing, can you hear me? All right. I am deeply honored to be here, to be with Dr. Bantam, to be with you all, and to have the singular honor of being allowed to give this lecture. Coming to Seattle is always a joy. This is such a beautiful part of the world. I always think to myself, can I move Yale to Seattle? But I don't think that's going to happen. In fact, I'm in negotiations with my dear spouse. We've lived in North Carolina for 28 years, and we are transitioning to Yale after those many years at Duke. And my wife is Bermudian, and so she's moving to the cold. And hopefully she'll come to love me again. Right now, across this country, there is a new wind blowing. A new kind of activism is emerging. We saw it in North Carolina with the Moral Monday movements. I had the joy and have the joy of participating in that movement, sharing a cell with many others. Being arrested, and there is the Black Lives Matter movement, another powerful movement that is challenging the status quo and bringing forward voices that we've never heard before, and reminding many of us who were alive when the civil rights movement was growing that there is a future, there is courage, and there are young people especially, that have much to say and demand to be heard. Well, both these movements for me raise a profound question that I want to explore with you this evening, and it's this. What is the relationship between the artistic and the prophetic? What is the relationship between the artistic and the prophetic? Maybe another way to ask this question is, what do artists have to do with prophets? Identifying an artist is a fairly easy thing to do. But where are the prophets today? Or maybe my friends, a more precise question would be, who is prophesying today, even at this very moment? We could make this an exclusively Christian question, but there are prophets in many religions. And so the question is germane to many religions. Who is prophesying today? I've always imagined the artistic to be bound to the prophetic, even to be the other side of the prophetic. I believe that the artist and the prophet call to each other through time, echoing back and forth the possibilities of newness, of life more abundant, life in freedom with God. Yet at this moment, we are in great need, I do emphasize great, we are in great need of an embodied articulation of their deep connection. An embodied articulation of the deep connection between the artistic and the prophetic. The artistic and the prophetic are modes of life that must, I say must, not should, be joined together in us. The artistic and the prophetic. Now, these are two big and nebulous concepts that could mean almost anything. But my use of them has a very specific home, my home. I am a Christian theologian, and more importantly, to the point, a great lover of music, especially jazz, the great American music. It entered my soul around the same time gospel music and sacred hymn began to give shape to the contours of my feelings and dreams. My parents, like most of the church folks who raised me, upheld a strict separation between the sacred and secular sounds. I never really heard the difference in the way they heard it. All the music of my youth, in and out of church, was blues drenched, jazz laden, or should I say, gospel drenched, gospel laden, gospel gesturing. I was born and raised inside the sounds of music. The music was not simply placed in me, I was placed in the music. It exists and existed like an eternal stream flowing all around and through me. Like so many other theologians raised in the church, I cannot imagine things theological apart from things artistic. It was not only listening to the music, but also the visual experience of watching people playing, singing, dancing, that helped introduce me to God, much like the introduction for people in other faiths. The singing, dancing, movement, the movement on the body. If I listened carefully and looked intently, I could catch glimpses of something not definable, certainly not quantifiable, but nonetheless actually present. I would like to call it the work of the Holy Spirit, the operations of grace on the human creature. I saw and heard people yield to God. I saw the Spirit of God working on and through bodies. At heart, this is what it means to be prophetic, to allow the Spirit to give voice to our bodies, to the depths of the human life that God has created, to allow the Spirit to give voice through our bodies, to the depths of the divine life God has joined to our lives. Giving voice to the depths. This holy work is what binds the prophetic to the artistic, giving voice to the depths. The arts often give sight, sound, smell, touch, and taste to the depths of human life and the divine life. But the gift of expression is too small a phrase to capture this incredibly joined work. It is essentially the performance of the truth that could become a truth that sets us free and leads to emancipatory action. The artist joined to the prophetic could set us free. Obviously, we're talking about what for many people are two absolutely frightening and volatile realities, the religious and the artistic, the prophet and the artist. But here lies the possibilities of a freedom that frightens others, some, and excites others. That possibility of freedom that gives witness to abundant life shared by all is desperately needed now. The prophetic mode of life sees what is going on, as Marvin Gaye sang so eloquently, sees what is going on, and refuses to remain silent about what is seen and known. That is the prophetic mode. It will not be silent. It will shout, "Black Lives Matter," and interrupt a candidate. It will speak. And joined to the artistic mode of life, it plumbs the depths of what must be seen and known and extends the range and volume of what must be said. The artistic extends the range and volume of the prophetic, of what must be said. Together, they could call us to action and invite us to transformation. We need these joined modes of life at this moment in order to overcome the sophisticated modes of denial that characterize so much of contemporary life in the Western world. Our current modes of denial turn us toward death. Here we must think of death less as a natural phenomenon and more as a force that seeks to take as much of life as possible. That is what death is about. The question we must ask ourselves is how and when do we become agents of death? We become death servants when we allow ourselves to be silent and complacent, not only in the face of explicable suffering, but also as we live reconciled to economic operations and social practices which inflict that suffering. We become death's best agents. The sophisticated modes of denial that engulf us traffic in fear and invite us to perform our lives in relentless anxiety over everything. If there is anything that the prophetic and the artistic modes of life are posed to attack, it is the power of fear. Yet the power of fear grows precisely in the psychic spaces where we operate in modes of denial. Tonight I want to point out two such modes, the mode of concealment, and secondly, the mode of consumption. The mode of concealment and the mode of consumption. The mode of concealment denies history, and the mode of consumption denies our organic connection, our deep connection to the lives of others. Both these modes of denial grow out of the abiding reality of displacement, in which we live disconnected from the land, disconnected from animals, and even from our own bodies. So first, a few thoughts on concealment. Than on consumption, the mode of concealment. The literary critic Roland Barthes, in his famous book Mythologies, noted that one of the myths the upper middle class in France, and by implication in the Western world, inhabited was what might be called the fictive middle. The fictive middle was a way of reading all political and social struggles as being between two eternal sides of contention, a political and social left, and a political and social right. Barthes, who wrote this book in the 1950s, noted that the fictive middle was a position claimed by those in power who imagined themselves always balanced, always between the political and the social extremes. Sound familiar? However, the middle they claimed was nothing more than a fiction that allowed them to maintain the status quo. Those in the fictive middle engaged in what he called neither nor criticism, claiming to be neither too far to the left nor too far to the right. And from that imagined position, being able to critique others, able to see the weaknesses of others' intellectual, social, and even moral position. Imagining oneself in the fictive middle meant, in effect, doing nothing. That's what the middle means. You do nothing. Indeed, the fictive middle was created by those in power as a way to understand the world from their position, without ever saying that this was a view from their position. The fictive middle, in which the world is equally divided between two options, serves only one option, the option to resist radical change and the overturning of the current economic, political, social arrangements of the Western world. So much of American history, especially since the Cold War, could be captured in this work of cultivating this fictive middle. What we would now call a binary way of thinking, Roland Barthes in the 1950s understood as a vision of life that denied history, denied real histories of slavery, oppression, wealth accumulation, very important history, often denied. Wealth accumulation and, of course, violence. So many of the religious, whether they be Christian or not, so many churches, pastors, theologians, have had their thinking shaped by this vision of the middle. The power of the fictive middle is that it can be narrated as the high moral ground where we stand between two contentious sides of any and every argument, every position, and seek to bring both sides together. The fictive middle can even be and has been imagined by many Christians as the position Jesus occupied between the Roman state and the revolutionaries of Israel, between the Sadducees and Pharisees. Jesus was crucified in this way of thinking precisely because he occupied the middle. Jesus, however, could never have occupied the fictive middle because it is fundamentally opposed to the prophetic. The words Jesus recited and made his own from the Hebrew scriptures, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free." These words announce divine desire. They expose a God willing to embrace and struggle with the creature to make things right. The prophetic can never exist in the middle, and neither should the artistic. Artistic vision, caught in the illusion of a middle, will always conceal more than it reveals. The issue, my friends, is not, and I want to be clear here, the issue is not artistic freedom. Nor am I rehearsing the old, tired arguments about political or apolitical art. Everything pivots on denial or truth-telling, on revelation or concealment. And we need artistic practice so bound to prophetic practice that by its very nature, it not only makes visible the operations of death, but also points to life. We need prophetic practice so bound to artistic practice that it opens multiple routes around death toward life, exposing a creativity, exposing a creativity that overcomes death's eager hunger for our lives and exposes those who have knowingly or unknowingly made themselves death's agents. Yet concealment as a mode of denial joins consumption as its collaborator, the mode of consumption. To consume, we believe within Christian thought, is holy work. It is tied to life. Consuming is tied to life. But what happens when it becomes bound to death? I do not mean the death of that which must be consumed, but consumption that conceals death's operations. Consumption that isolates us from one another and leaves us alone in our hungers. That kind of death-generating consumption now flows through our visual ecologies. The social theorist Jean Baudrillard noted a crucial aspect of this many years ago with his pivotal work on simulation. Baudrillard argued that for us, the reporting of real events, has been tightly aligned with the advertising and entertainment industry. The same technologies and procedures used for offering us goods and services and entertaining us also provides us with the news. So that the real, as he says, has been bound to the simulation. Being bound to simulation does not mean that the real is the truth and the simulation is the lie. It means that we trust the truth. We trust that truth may be known and disseminated through simulation. We trust that the real may be represented to us in a variety of ways. What often goes unarticulated is the linkage of these various ways of simulation. The commercial, the movie, the television show, the tweet, the news report, the radio interview, the Facebook post, the book, art, news, comedy, tragedy, all these stages for representation align and draw us toward inhabiting one primary mode of response. Spectating. What happens in us when the football game happens, like the school shooting happens, like a new James Bond movie happens, like another event in the life of a reality television star happens, like Kim Kardashian, like more black deaths at the hands of the police happen, like a hurricane or a tornado or a protest or a political candidate speech happens. We don't lose our ability to distinguish these different happenings. But the longitudinal and cumulative effect is that the meaning and energy of these events gets evened out and neutralized. The meaning is there, but neutralized. We react to these spectacles by watching, that is, by consuming. The first action of consumption, that is, watching, often exhausts any subsequent social action. Our response, Baudrillard argued, I think convincingly, our response to what we see is to see. That's it. Our response to what we see is to see. Yet Baudrillard's famous account of these matters illumines another equally tragic reality of this kind of consumption. We lose our ability to see ourselves as actually connected to one another as real bodies in space and time. A sense of connection, Baudrillard believes, should lead us to act out of concern for one another. What keeps us from sensing our connection to one another is, in fact, the constant alignment of simulation. As we see the masses in joy, the masses in hatred doing violence, the masses protesting, the masses suffering, and we observe their collective pathos, we often forget that we are the masses. Now, there is certainly more that fuels our sense of disconnection, but Baudrillard is onto something important for us. This form of consumption not only engenders an antisocial quietism, a kind of corrupt contemplation, but it also isolates us from one another in our seeing, hearing, sensing, and knowing. A consumption that does not connect us and that does not drive us to deeper concern and care for one another is one that only leads toward isolation and death. To see and not do is to move toward isolation and death. But here is the question. Can there be a form of artistic practice joined to prophetic practice that might productively play in the alignment of entertainment, news, and advertising, opening up the possibilities within our visual ecologies to join us together in not simply consuming, but in doing the good? I disagree with those ethicists, theologians, and others who imagine the possibility of breaking that alignment. It is here forever. It will never go away. So to simply cut your TV off and try to purify yourself is a waste of time. The alignment is here forever. Entertainment, advertising, and news are here forever. But could the artist play in the alignment? Do something with the alignment? I believe there can be such a joint practice. Could there be a form of prophetic practice joined to artistic practice that turns our consumptive habits toward life and enlivens our desire to know one another? I believe there can be such a joint practice that overcomes these modes of denial. In what remains of my time, and I know there's not much, I would like to consider a few gestures that might aid in the formation of this practice. And I apologize to those of you who are not inside the Christian theological discourse. As a theologian, I'm going to now play in the scripture, play with the Bible as a way to do this. So bear with me as I do this. I want to tell a Bible story. play with this. There is this story in the Christian scriptures in the book of Acts about two disciples of Jesus who are arrested for healing a poor man. So I want you to just remember the outline of the story. They are arrested for healing a poor man. Once they are arrested, they are examined. They are threatened not to do anything in the name of Jesus, the prophet who they follow, who they believe is God. And they simply said, forget you, we're going to do what we need to do. That's just the basic outlines of the story. So in Acts chapter 4, these two disciples named Peter and John were arrested for healing a poor and destitute man who sat at the gate of the Jewish temple. He sat at the gate of the temple. And in the story, in the earlier chapter, they encountered this man who, as I said, was poor and destitute, engaged in a desperate pattern of begging. They're begging, asking for help to, to, from anybody who looked by, and most people ignored him. Peter interrupted his plea with crucial words. Look at us. Look at us. This is what Peter said to the poor man. And at that moment, eyes met. Peter and his companion, John, gazed at this man, and the man looked attentively back at them. This man anticipated receiving the signs of an economic relation, the symbols that indicate that ever-present imbalance between the haves and the have-nots. This gaze between them suggested the usual, but its intensity soon opened to something much more. There with these disciples, the poor and needy will not be overlooked. There at the beginning of what we call a post-Pentecostal reality of life as a Christian, followers of Jesus, people will be seen fully, strongly, clearly. Equally important, Peter speaks a necessary optical reciprocity. A necessary optical reciprocity. Look at us. Here is where the artistic and the prophetic converge in the paying attention and in the attending to suffering and need. The disciples of Jesus see and are seen. Both are necessary for the truth to be known. The attention paid sets the stage for words and actions to be heard and felt, and makes way for responses that signal a change of life. The poor and needy, the suffering and the destitute must be seen. And they in turn, they see, they watch, they observe. The artistic and the prophetic circle endlessly around this optical reciprocity. The poor and the destitute must be seen. And they, in turn, they see, they watch, they understand. Here we find a possibility. A first gesture that, if magnified and enhanced, might give witness to the truth. This first gesture shares the burden and the joy of paying attention and presses into the exquisite details of life for the sake of life. Pay attention. Now, of course, paying attention is not a new thing. All artists pay attention. But attention that circles around the conditions of oppression and poverty, injustice and violence, and then builds up and out in ever-widening circles of sight and hearing, touching and knowing. Now, that would be different. That would be new. So a question, obviously, that you should have if you've been listening carefully, which of course you have. Must all art give witness to suffering and pain? Must all art give witness to suffering and pain? I think the obvious answer is of course not. But attending and considering carefully art should, as Elaine Scarry suggests, open us to seeing suffering and pain. Unfortunately, Scarry's account of art and beauty, Scarry's hope, lacks the truth that can only be established with the prophetic. Only if we understand who and what God wants us to see, only if we see whose bodies are in pain and being broken, as we see other things, as we hear other things, can paying attention for the artist lead from the operations of death toward life. Paying attention that matters begins by paying attention to this. These disciples of Jesus paid attention to this poor and destitute man, and through the name of Jesus, they healed him. And for that good work, for paying attention and seeing what others had learned not to see, they were arrested. To see and speak and act is to align ourselves with the actions of the prophet. To see and speak and act is to align ourselves with the actions of the prophet, those of us inside the Christian faith called Jesus. Jesus was predestined to challenge those in power and confront the power, spiritual and human. This moment was inevitable. The disciples knew this confrontation was coming. The struggle against those in power that marked the life and death of Jesus was coming to them as well. It comes because of the location of disciples. It is always about location. The disciples are among common people proclaiming liberation, and that violence and death are no longer the ultimate power. There, from the sight of the common, disciples are seen as criminals. They become what Edward Said called social critics, secular critics, who unrelentingly call into question the gods of this age, that is, the prevailing social, cultural, political, economic, and academic logics that support or are at ease with the status quo of grotesquely differentiated wealth and poverty, uneven access to the necessary resources for life and health, and forms of sublimely stubborn oppression masked inside social conventions. Yet a status quo is always embodied in people with real power, the power to imprison and torture us. So in the story, Peter and John are arrested, as I said, questioned and threatened, told never to speak or teach or touch or help anyone in the name of that prophet Jesus. The prophetic mode of life is a mode of life always confronted by the power of fear and the threat of violence. I mentioned when I first began my involvement with the Moral Monday movement, one of my best friends is William Barber, the founder and architect of it. And very early, as we were doing our work, very early he started getting threats against his life. And eventually the threats got so thick and so heavy, he had to ask people to not simply pray for him, but watch out for him. People who could do that. The threats come when you confront the powers. Yet the response of Peter and John was paradigmatic. Peter speaks boldly, declaring that the life of Jesus continues after death, so they will continue to obey him. Heed his voice, proclaim his message. This is a different kind of boldness Peter speaks. He speaks boldly. It is not the result of character refinement or moral formation. Peter has not become the great man who stares down his enemies with epic courage, the kind that creates an odyssey or heroic tale. Indeed, there is no such thing as individual boldness for the followers of this prophet Jesus. Of course, each disciple must and can be bold, but their boldness is always a together boldness, a joined boldness, a boldness born of intimacy. The modern lie of individualism is most powerful when we imagine that boldness comes from within. It does not. It comes from without, from the Spirit of God. The disciples gathered together and asked for what came from without. The words there in the story, if you had read the story, knew the story, are poignant. The disciples say, now, great God, look at their threats and grant to your servants to speak your words with boldness, with all boldness. They see the threat, they pray, and they ask for boldness. They see the threat, they pray, and they ask for boldness. This moment sets the template for the movement, for any movement that is of the prophetic. We saw it in the civil rights movement. We see it in movements today. The request for boldness, a communal request, illumines a second gesture filled with the possibility of forming communities of witness that locate this vital resource needed for the struggles of this moment. The boldness of an artist or a prophet is not the new thing, but a boldness born of a community joined in hope, joined in plea, that then resources artistic practice. Now, that would be an extraordinary thing. Imagine a boldness that builds, ever increasing the strength of conviction, the clarity of action, and the power of hope. Even more importantly, imagine an artistic boldness freed from self-indulgence and narcissism. Imagine an artistic boldness freed from self-indulgence and narcissism, and that gifts us with artistic works that illumine courageous paths toward life. Imagine art that invites us to ask for boldness. Such boldness grasps the imperative of improvisation as a way of life, and experimentation as a strategy for freedom. A bold community takes risks. A bold community obligates itself to improvisation for the sake of life. The disciples prayed and God shook the place. Back to this story. The Holy Spirit comes and fills the disciples and they speak, but the speaking is already a joined speaking, a chorus of faith. They speak with boldness. The shaking of the Spirit in the story, fill in the story a little bit more for you. So they asked for boldness, and then the room in which they were, it started shaking. The room started shaking. It wasn't a party. It wasn't a party going on. It's just, the room just started shaking. And the shaking of the Spirit is not simply a sign of power, but of pleasure. God's excitement is evident here. Here and now, God's people are one, calling on the faith and boldness of the prophet Jesus to do the divine will. Here and now, the new order confronts the old order, and God sees the unfolding of divine desire in and among God's creatures. This is the Spirit's quivering joy exposed in the impartation of holy power. Yet what comes to the disciples now is not simply boldness. In fact, boldness is not the ultimate gift, but the intensification of the common. The common is the gift realized in the Spirit. This part of that story unfolds. This part of that story unfolds with the new order of giving, rooted in the divine wanting, rooted in the divine desire to join together. So another piece of the story. So after they prayed for boldness, after the Spirit came, that's when they decided that they must give up all their possessions, sell them, and give all the money so that they can start to build a new community. That if any was lacking, they would share, they would pool their resources, they would redistribute their wealth. They'd redistribute their wealth in order to care for those in need. So these followers of Jesus release themselves to one another, making themselves responsible for and accountable to one another. Matters of money are inescapable. They are the heart of discipleship, but they are not the heart of discipleship. Money here will be used to destroy what money normally is used to create: distance and boundaries between people. And of course, we are yet to clearly hear this ancient strategy of the prophetic. Too often in the reading of this story, it's clouded by the spectacular giving, that is, people selling all that they had, giving the money so that others may have. We're blinded by that spectacular giving, and we miss what's even more spectacular, the joining. Now these followers of this prophet Jesus will become the bridge between uneven wealth and resources, uneven hope and uneven life. Those who have must join those who do not have, and those who have neither a lot nor just a little must hear the call to offer themselves for the sake of a God who feverishly seeks to create the common. This is the common that the Spirit of God is seeking to create in and through all people. We are to become the bridges between the haves and have-nots, not simply as an economic arrangement, but a rearrangement of life. The Spirit is pressing us toward the common, to life together in the real spaces of this world, geographic and material, spatial and communal. In the common, the illusion of a political, social, and even a theological middle gives way to a life of joining, where we enter into a shared project of life, finding ways to constantly bridge worlds purposely constructed to be separated. And here, finally, I spy out a third possibility in this part of the story of creating the common. A third gesture activated in the space between the artistic and the prophetic. There, in that hope-filled space, we find artistic and prophetic practice that forms the common. Imagine artistic practice aimed at forming the common. Imagine artistic practice that seeks to join people and invites people to see who and what they might become, and that is bridges between the haves and the have-nots. Artistic practice that brings the common to life. So, these three gestures of cultivating attention to all things from the sight of suffering and pain, embedding a communal prayer and plea for boldness in the artistic imagination, and imagining the common as the space from which to construct identity and life, outline a hope for prophetic arts that will be for this moment and will undo the modes of denial that plague all of us. As I said when I first began, I have seen glimpses of these prophetic arts in the Moral Monday and Black Lives Matter movements. I have seen people of every walk of life, every religion, people who believe and people who believe nothing, people who think religion is wonderful and people who think it's a problem, join hands, sing songs, and not simply stop there, walk into legislative buildings, present new policy to legislators, and press them to change. Of course, that's just a glimpse. But imagine what might be done if the artistic and the prophetic are joined in us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Jennings, for a powerful lecture and a reminder of the ways in which we can see in new ways. We have about half an hour now left, and so we would just love the opportunity for folks to want to interact, ask questions for anything that was brought up. It's just really, really good to see so many different people and ways in which we've been able to kind of intersect our community. So I'm really, really glad to see so many faces here tonight. So Day has our microphone, so just give him a signal if you'd like to ask a question, and then we'll put you up.
I don't need a microphone, but you talked a lot about prophetic art and the prophets, and I thought all of that was like really dope. But part of what I'm thinking is, what about all the nonprofits? What do those people do? Because I feel like we live in a culture that says that everybody is special and everybody needs to be at the front. It might even say that everybody is a prophet, but that's actually false. So I'm wondering, and this may be totally tangent away from what you're actually discussing, but I'm wondering, how do people serve, how do people engage when they're not the prophet or that's not their gift, how do they still interact?
That's a great question. I always think that we should follow that nice distinction that's present in the Hebrew Bible and the Christian scriptures, that there are prophets, but there's also the reality that everyone can be prophetic. Mm-hmm. And I want to press in on the fact that everyone can be prophetic, that everyone can, to use Marvin Gaye's famous words, everybody can see what's going on, open their mouth and speak. And I think this is part of what we want to come after, the idea that only there's only a special few who have the courage to stand up and speak against the suffering, speak against the evil, speak against what should not be. But we all should. And there are moments, I would argue, there are moments when the prophetic is on each of us. On each of us. When instead of calling it being irritated by, let's say, oh, I don't know, Monsanto's. Yeah, I'm sorry. There are moments when, instead of saying that I'm just irritated or I'm just frustrated, why not recognize that that might not be the prophetic? And what one should do is ask, how and to whom might I speak? The famous words of Edward Said, it is important to speak truth to power. That's not just for intellectuals. Mm-hmm. It's for everyone. Mm-hmm. So I would say, let's all open our eyes and attune ourselves to the possibilities of being prophetic. I have two wonderful daughters. One has a great voice and one does not. I love them both. But my one who does not, she loves to sing. And of course, there are many people who cannot sing, but that doesn't stop them from singing. There are many people who will never be William Barber. But that does not stop each of us from saying, this is not right, and this is what must be done. Great question. Thank you. They're in deep contemplation.
I do need a mic.
Good.
So how can all this be played out in the worship of the church, in our liturgy, and how we do our services? Can it take place on the Sunday morning or the Saturday, whatever? And also, like, obviously it takes place outside of that, but how can we incorporate that into our worship as a community?
I think the first thing to do is to start to pay attention. And here it's always important for communities to not simply make use of their artists, but listen to their artists. That's a different matter.
Yeah.
Pay attention to what artists pay attention to, and imagine that what the artist does is not just a gift, but a practice.
Yeah.
A practice that we all need to engage in.
Yeah.
Someone with an excellent ear helps us understand what it means to listen. Someone who's attuned in their poetry to the subtleties of pain and suffering, there's a pedagogy for us inside of that.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say begin by entering into the reality of the artist first, and recognize that an artist's gifts, an artistic practice, is for the world, not simply for the church. Not inside, that is, but inside the building of the church. Start there. Great question. Please ask that dear woman who's going to, like, introduce herself. I want everybody to know who that is. Please stand up and tell us who you are.
The little person is here. Jennings. My name is Laura Lasworth, and we were on a panel together this afternoon.
fabulous artist.
Well, thank you, sir.
And what is your website? What's your website?
LauraLazarus.com. What I think I hear you saying now, and maybe this is a bit of the divide here, is the artistic practice can often be compartmentalized into those people who sing or dance or paint or, mm-hmm. but I think I hear you begging a call for is to creativity and the imagination. Yeah. So that wherever a person's place of work is, whatever their vocation, profession is, there are opportunities, there are moments where it's very clear, oh, is this the moment I have to speak? Is this the moment I might get fired? You know, is this the moment I stick my neck out? And that's where the creativity comes in. You know, how do we, when those moments arise, not be a voice that burns the house down, but that can engage in a creative way to move. And so I guess I'm asking you to speak to that a little bit.
You just said it so beautifully, eloquently. That's exactly right. The possibility of bringing to the moments when we need to speak the kind of creative possibilities, not simply of raining down judgment. Yes, that might be necessary. But speaking creatively into the space where no one believes a possibility exists. That what we are in desperate need of is the artistic at the site of devastation. How can things be built? How can things be turned toward life? We need an artistic practice woven to the prophetic that can capture us in the midst of what others imagine. It's done, it's over. There's no possibility here. No, there is a possibility. Mm-hmm. And here, let me think out of the nothing. Mm-hmm. Let me think out of the rubble. Yeah. There is a wonderful book by Susan Natal called Beauty Ugly, which talks about South African artists who all their material is that which is thrown away. Imagine all your artistic materials are what others have thrown away. What does it mean to do creativity at the sight of trash? Mm-hmm. At the sight of, you know, devastation, of things being, but this is where you do your best work. And the life that springs out of death, out of the throwaway, that speaks back to a culture that throws away, that's the artistic. And imagine that joined to the prophetic. That's what we're trying to say, that you can bring critique, but you can also create at the site of critique. Mm-hmm. But you need prophets, and you need artists, and you need the artistic mode that is in us, the prophetic mode that is in each of us, to finally join together. There are many who imagine themselves artistic, but they do not imagine themselves prophetic. There are many who imagine themselves prophetic, but they have forgotten how to create. Yeah. You gotta create. And you can create at the site where others have said there's nothing here. Black folks have done that from the very beginning. Mm-hmm. Created at the site where others have said there's nothing here. Yes?
You know, I love what you're saying, but I think it will play at a seminary or a divinity school, but we're in the midst of the University of Washington, where there is a fever in our students to get ahead. Our parents who are afraid their kids will not get work, and there's deep fear and that fever to get ahead. So the arts are pushed to the margins. You know, playfulness is just left out. And, you know, I find my students and my students are in debt. And our state legislature doesn't want to give money to the university.
Right.
Or to our schools. So, I mean, you know, talking about a system that has paralyzed people who might want to speak. And you know, so I think, you know, I experience this with my students and a growing rate of anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
That they're just up against it, and what are they gonna do? You know, and obviously I'm with you.
Yeah.
You know, we use our artistic design to create Amazon.
Right.
And, you know, how would the prophetic speak in the midst of that kind of fever, fear, and using our creativity to make money?
Great question. See, I think we have to come at this at two crucial levels. The one you stated. If there's anything the artistic and the prophetic can speak against, it's the power of fear. And bring a creativity at the sight of fear, right? And look, if there's anything that must be cultivated in an education, it's a creativity that overcomes fear.
Right.
Now, but also remember at another level what's going on around us. Any number of companies have decided that creativity is absolutely crucial for their future. Any number of companies have created free playrooms. I mean, there's this wonderful documentary on San Francisco. Have you ever seen San Francisco 2.0? I recommend you see it. It's about the horrible takeover of the land of property in San Francisco. But inside of that, really important documentary, it's talking about these new companies, startup companies in San Francisco, which have these playrooms for their employees because they realize you can't be productive if you can't be creative. And what creates creative possibility is play. So creativity is crucial, quote unquote, for a productive workforce. But I want a larger possibility. And that larger possibility has to do with the creativity that might reimagine the world.
Mm-hmm.
Reimagining the world is not a luxury. It is a necessity. It's a necessity for all of us, and especially people at the bottom, to reimagine and to try to enact what they imagine. If not, you die.
Right.
And the greatest, most powerful artists are those who understand, I will imagine a possibility against another. Now, I want that kind of desperate, courageous, communal boldness, if it can be made communal, to become infectious and move to other people. I do believe that within Christianity, there are some possibilities that aid this. And so in that regard, I think there's some resources that even a university can make use of. Well, that's a great question, Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, see a hand?
Thank you again, Dr. Jennings, for your words of wisdom. I think this may piggyback off the last question,
uh-huh.
But I'm wondering how a prophetic imagination and artistic imagination can speak to issues of humanity. How can these come together in order to talk about not really a theological anthropology, but a better way of talking about humanity so that when we are consuming spectacles, we have to realize somehow that we are consuming spectacles of humanity. And I think that's what we're losing oftentimes in these conversations. We're losing the humanness of other people.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk to that?
Yeah, well, here's my hope that there can be artistic practice that performs the human. In fact, Dr. Banham said this earlier today, part of what's crucial, I'm quoting you, Dr. Banham, part of what's crucial is that the artist doesn't begin with a concept or an abstract idea. The artist begins with material, with sound, you know, with word in play, and in working with their material, performs the reality that they're, this is trying to conjure for us all to see. So the humanity has to be performed in that regard. And performed in such a way that I would want it to be inescapable for us. One could walk away, but one could not walk away easily. That's the hope, the performance of humanity that makes possible an appreciation, even a love for humanity. But of course, as I was saying, I think it requires a new kind of attention, an attention that begins with those who suffer and are at the bottom, who face conditions that threaten life at every moment. Perform the quest for humanity from that sight so that we might see what it really means to be human. I think that's where we want to start.
Hey, I'll see if I can get this question out. All right. So I originally come from Minneapolis, where the Black Lives Matter movement is very strong, and have had the privilege of marching alongside and paying attention and listening to voices that I hadn't been exposed to, and certainly people who have raised me hadn't been exposed to. You talk about the voices at the bottom, or the people suffering, having this creative potential to reimagine, and sometimes my concern in being a creative or prophetic voice in response to what I've noticed is that I fail to notice enough, and that my speaking or my creating would minimize rather than magnify those voices at the bottom. And so I'm wondering from you if you could speak to how I might posture myself in such a way that I'm magnifying those voices.
That's a great question. Yeah. I want to build the common, imagine artistic practice joined, artistic practice that builds community, that in fact needs others. Of course, you can hear the kind of musical gestures behind what I'm saying, and in many ways that's paradigmatic for me. A great musician needs other musicians. And my hope is for artistic practice that does that kind of collaboration. But you are pointing out a serious problem, and that is the problem of white privilege, white supremacy, and the ways in which white voices easily overwhelm the voices of those who are not white. The challenge is not silence, necessarily, depending on who's talking. But the answer is not silence. It is attunement, right? Again, the musical analogy. The best bands can hear each other, and yet they speak their own sound. The best bands can hear each other, right? You can always hear the bass player, even though you're playing the piano. You can always hear the drummer. And a band that has played together so long, they can feel where the other wants to go. Imagine that. Imagine artistic and prophetic community that feels one another at that level and builds toward the possibilities of the new because they know how to speak and listen. This is always one of the challenges. Some people speak well, listen poorly. Others listen too long and never speak. A hand up here.
Hello. First of all, I love your glasses.
Thank
this
you.
Is the first note I wrote
was rad glasses.
I appreciate that.
I was
wondering, I was very fascinated by what you talked about in terms of the fictive middle.
Yeah.
And I think, I think I'm wondering how you, really the Pacific Northwest, we're very politically correct up here. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people in the fictive middle. They like to talk about it, they like to critique, but they're not doing anything. Mm-hmm. And even myself, I find myself doing that in certain situations and with certain topics. And I guess, how do you help somebody move themselves out of that? Because that's such a safe place to be, that's such an easy place to be. How do you convince somebody that it's worth it to step out of that safe place? I think, yeah, especially as young people, it can be really scary to put yourself out there. You know, so, I don't know. Not that it's my job to say, like, get out of there, that's terrible. But, I don't know. How do you approach
that? That's a great question. What we have to recognize is that it takes incredible energy to stay in the fictive middle. It's not easy to be there. You have to work. And what do you have to work at? You have to work at a kind of denial of history. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing you have to work at. But the second thing is you have to become, in many ways, tone deaf and blind to the texture of people's stories. When you start to hear people's stories, the story of how someone lost everything and wound up on the street. Mm-hmm. That starts to the illusion, that cloud that one thinks is the middle starts to starts to fade away, because the real texture of lives show that that's not a space. Mm-hmm. And of course, this is where the artist can do her work beautifully, mm-hmm. to gain and move into the textures of people's lives. Such that the telling of the story makes it impossible to be in the middle. So you when you hear powerful stories rendered, whether it be in song or in story or in play, it takes effort to step back into the middle after you've heard that. I mean, you realize you're stepping back into this false thing, because that story, when you heard it, pulled you out. It exposed that, no, there's no middle. This demanded something of me. Yeah. But now it's over, and I'm going to step back over here. What does it mean to inhabit the courage, the boldness of that artist who told the story, and make that the space in which you constantly live, so that fictive middle is not even a possibility for you? Mm-hmm. Now, of course, we do understand that there is an honest impulse inside the fictive. What is that honest impulse? The honest impulse is not to be lost in the chaos of argument and fight. We understand. But the question is, how might we make argument, disagreement, productive? How might it lead toward life? Yeah. The fictive middle is not a position of life. It is a position of avoidance, and it's a lie. But how might we move argument toward life? You know, there are people who are going to disagree strongly, but what an artist can do is draw the disagreement towards someplace else, place it in a space where it can do different work. A beautiful documentary that shows the textures of someone's plight. Let's put the debate inside that. And all of a sudden, it could become. But of course, let's remember, the fictive middle serves a particular reality. It serves the political, social, and economic status quo. It serves you doing nothing. Because you doing nothing is doing something. I once had a student that said to me, Dr. James, I think it's a waste of time to vote. I said, not to vote is to vote. Mm-hmm. Not to vote is to vote. You just voted for the status quo by not voting. There is no place to hide. Mm-hmm. So don't even try.
Dr. Jennings, you'd mentioned Jean Baudrillard as part of your lecture, and Bulliard, one of his most famous essays was that the, you know, that 9/11 never happened, right? And so, and his whole thesis was that because of the levels of simulation, simulacra that's piled up because of the news sources, we can never get to the real of that event, right? It's forever regressive from our ability to touch it.
That's a frightening thesis.
And of course it blew up and, you know, millions of undergraduates had to read it as a result of that, right?
Your hands are shaking.
Yeah, that's right. But one of the things, the outcomes of that, and I'm curious, when you evoked it, was that part of what Bulliard is getting at is that the more we try to create something to get at the real, we remove ourselves from the real. And it's like we'll never be able to get to the real at the moment that we create something to get at it. And you spoke about aligning artists and prophets and not turning off the television, not turning necessarily, you know, this is never going to go away, so we have to align ourselves. How do you put that together in some ways? Because is there the potential, for example, and particularly with, I mean, the prophetic importance that I feel right now with Black Lives Matter and the issue that is there, that we have to move from talking to doing, to deconstructing and dismantling institutions that are killing bodies, right? Is the creation of the prophetic art going to remove me more from the reality of just getting my hands in the midst of doing something? So, I mean, and that's why I'm trying to push against Bulliard a little bit. I'm kind of curious about if I could, yeah.
Well, and at that point, I agree with you. I'll push against his pessimism.
Yeah.
Which I consider French pessimism. I push against his pessimism there because, for me, the elusive touch of the real is not what's at play here.
Yeah.
Not for the artist, right? And not for the prophet, not for the prophetic or the artistic. What's at play here is the possibilities of capturing action, right? And here, I would prefer to think, and it would be interesting to do an analysis of what the new media has meant for this, right? I have an 18-year-old daughter who's a freshman in college, and she is as politically active as I would want. But, you know, like so many of those of you are, she's tuned in to, you know, everything she's supposed to be tuned in terms of media. And so that's not even the question, access to the real. It's access to your own agency. I think that's what's really at play. And here's where I would want to step away from what I call the obsession with epistemology. Okay. Obsession with how we know what we know. Let's just leave that alone. We don't have to be obsessed with epistemology. I'd rather us be obsessed with the possibilities of agency.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a great question.
Jennings, thank you so much for your talk.
Hello, doctor.
I want to ask a sort of urban geography kind of question.
Oh, good.
You brought up San Francisco 2.0.
And yeah.
You brought up the sort of the way that, you know, in a way, when you were talking about San Francisco 2.0, you were sort of talking about gentrification as if it were an artistic creative process as well.
Actually, I should have been more careful because I was trying to talk about just the one little sliver of good inside of that. one little sliver of good inside of that. But anyway.
Right. But those people still would imagine themselves to be artists, if not even prophets. And so I was wondering whether that is a perversion of what you're talking about.
Oh, yeah.
And what answer would you have to give to people who would style themselves as such?
Well, see, excellent question, doctor. Thank you so much. Again, I want to encourage you all. It's an HBO documentary. I'll encourage you all to watch it, San Francisco 2.0, because it's coming here. It's coming to every town in your neighborhood. The story of the rich and powerful, the folks who used to work in the valley now moving to San Francisco because they want to be in the city, and buying up all the property and displacing almost everyone. They're even taking over the projects, kicking people out of the projects and turning it into high rises. I have to be careful because those of us who are interested in geography and race and justice, these things get us very excited. Artistic possibility, artistic practice can and does often exist inside these kinds of points of these realities of isolation. This is what we have to challenge. We have to challenge artistic practice. We have to challenge ways of being creative that enfold back in upon themselves. This is why I was a little hesitant as I was responding to your really great question earlier about the use of creativity. There are a lot of corporations very interested in creativity, but their interest in creativity has nothing to do with what we've been talking about for the last hour and a half, right? Right. It's creativity that's shaped solely for the purpose of the market. A creativity that, in a sense, is inside the blinding effects of art that is inside the modes of denial. I do want to imagine artistic practice that overcomes modes of denial, because there is artistic practice that is inside modes of denial. And I think we have to face that. We have to face the fact that there are some artists who, brilliant, wonderful, yet their work is inside precisely covering suffering and pain. Gifts, as it were, being used for death. What does it mean to be an artist and be an agent of death as an artist? So I think we want to face that reality. I say these things a bit hesitantly because I love artists. And I think the world needs more of us to enter into the artistic mode of existence. But I also recognize that artists have been at the heart of some of the most horrific realities of denial we've ever seen. You all know, one example that you all are very well, the artistic community in Nazi Germany. Some of the most brilliant artists we have ever seen in the modern world. That's not the kind of art. They were getting at your point. Yeah.
We have time for one more question.
And tell us your name.
My name is Sarah.
Before I ask your question, Brian, do you want to say something about Sarah?
Sarah has been our administrative wonder to help in support of all of this, so we should give her a hand.
Now, Sarah, you can ask your question. Go ahead.
Thank you. So my question is this. I was recently in Baltimore in Sandtown where Freddie Gray was killed. Freddie Gray was a black man who was killed by police a few months ago. And in Sandtown, there was a mural that was painted a few years ago of a black person and a white person shaking hands in some sort of reconciliatory gesture. And then after Freddie Gray was killed, a few blocks over, another mural was put up, people of color protesting against white male police officers in riot gear. The fact that these two murals are blocks away from one another and a mere block away from where Freddie Gray was killed, I just can't get these pictures out of my head and thinking about what's happening there. So I'm just wondering if you have a reflection on that at all.
Well, I do. My daughter's a freshman at Towson University, which is outside of Baltimore. And when I dropped her off college, as I like to do when I go to cities, I took the main street that the college is on, which is York Street, and I drove from one end of that street as far as I could to the other. I couldn't because I ran out of time. And I noticed as I drove what what you notice in almost every major city in America that has a street that runs through a good portion of it. That street ran from beautifully manicured homes, a beautiful downtown, a great mall, you know, wonderful little coffee shops where the Bohemians would sit out and drink coffee and think great thoughts, all the way down to dilapidated homes, boarded up houses, and poverty. It ran from white neighborhoods to Hispanic neighborhoods to black neighborhoods. And the only kind of car I saw consistently moving through it all, a police car. So you have to engage in artistic practice in such a place, which means that you have to tell the truth. The question we have to ask ourselves, Sarah, is why aren't those murals in the other part of town?
Yeah.
Mm. That's the question we have to ask. So there, I'm sure there are artists in the other part of town.
Right.
The question is why don't we have those there? I'm sure we have other kind of art there, but we don't have that. And that's why we need the prophetic and the artistic join together.
Thanks for having me. Thank you. Theology, University of Washington, Seattle Pacific. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Have a wonderful evening.